Okay, those of you who was 24 years old and below, you were not yet born when this incident happened in my life. Okay, I was a young executive. I was newly hired as the senior manager of a large multinational company as a senior manager for human resource. And in this company, I had two bosses. For the first time in my life, I had two bosses. One was a Spanish Basque. Okay, very easygoing, very friendly, and he was the vice president for human resource. And the other was an old guy. Okay, he was about, at that time, about 72 years old. Silent, quiet type. He would joke, but you know, yung joke niya is so deep, I cannot really understand, but since he's my boss, I would smile and laugh. Okay, depending on how loud his voice is, I would laugh as loud. He was my boss because I was handling both organizational development, human resource, and labor relations for the entire company. He was the lawyer, vice president for legal. And as I compared these two, I learned more from the old guy. Okay? And there's one thing that truly impacted me through him. He would, whenever we would enter into a CBA negotiation, and I would sit beside him, and whenever we talk to the union, what he would do is he would just sit, and he would sit this way, and he would just observe everyone. Okay? And so ako, gusto kong maging katulad niya, upo rin ako, sit this way, but I would observe him. And as he observes people, he would never talk to the person who is the loudest. He would never talk to the person who was voted as the president. But he would always address the people na tahimik. So nagtataka ako. Sabi ko, bakit kaya lagi siyang ina-address yun to me? At pagka in-address na yun and he receives an answer, he would always say, "Done. That's exactly what we will do." Okay? And everybody goes quiet, everybody stands up, and everybody's happy. So sabi ko, mukhang may magic. So one time, I was talking to him, and I asked him, sabi ko, why is it? Sabi ko, Ning, why is it that whenever we meet with the union, you never say anything, you just observe people, and then you talk to the person who sits quietly in the room, and after talking to him, he would always say, it's done, that's what we're going to do. And this is what he said. A leader observes. A leader observes the dynamics within the group that he is always talking to. A true leader is not exactly introspective, but with a focused direction in mind, he would observe the dynamics within the team. And he would observe whom the people would consider the person to whom the members of the team gravitates to. And he said, it is not always the noisiest. It is not always the elected president. It may not even be the vice president. So sabi ko, so paano mo malalaman? Sabi niya, the true leader in that group is the person that everybody looks at whenever they would speak. Sabi niya, tignan mo mabuti. Sabi niya, when the president speaks, they would look at us. But when the president starts to speak, or whoever officer starts to speak, the members, okay, yung mga audience, nakatingin sa amin. Pero yung nagsasalita, nakatingin sa isang tao, as if wanting the approval of that person. Sabi niya, obserbahan mo. They would stand, they would look at us, they would glance at that person, and that person would just nod his head, and he would talk to us, and he would look at that person, and everyone does that. And here's what he said. The power in that room does not rest on the president. It rests on the person to whom they always take affirmation from. And so he said, if you really want to establish a strong team, and you really want to impact people, observe them. Because if you never observe them, you will never see the potentials and you will never see kung sino ang dapat mong kakausapin. Now, fast forward, when I started to disciple, I realized, as I read scripture, that I believe that that is also the way Jesus did it. Jesus had 12, but he had 3 in his inner circle. Have you observed in scripture? Jesus had 12 disciples, but he always talked to 3 people, his inner circle. The people whom he, not really is his favorite, but the people that I believe he observed to have the potential and the thing that he needed to do to get the movement going. You see, my friends, when we start to disciple people, we may tend to miss out on the true leaders if we do not observe. Okay? Developing leaders is having an observant mind. It is looking at every single member in your group, looking at the dynamics among them, and seeing those nuggets, seeing those people that really shows interest. Seeing those people that really has a profound impact on the rest of the group. And identifying them and challenging them and leading them. In my group, right now, doon sa dinidisciple ko, as I mentioned, there was this guy. He was 23 years old at the time that he joined my group. Okay? And when my D group was storming, and I mean really storming, we went through such a storming phase. I literally drew a line on the ground and told everyone, okay, those who are with me, you join me. Totoo. Okay, we had such storming. I really thought that that group that I had, madidisband kami. Talagang sobra. Me and my wife, we were really crying. Until one time, I really drew a line. Okay, we were in a satellite, and we were in that room, and we were discussing. I got up, kasi I was seated, me and my wife were seated, and they were all seated across. I got up, and I really drew a line. And I told them, okay, if you still want me to be your D group leader, you better cross this line. Because the moment I step out of this room and I don't see people in this line, I would leave all of you. Okay? And there was this 23-year-old guy who was so level-headed, and he was the one who said, look, you know, yung pinag-aawayan natin, hindi naman importante yan, etc., etc. And that was when I saw that people was listening to him. He was 23 years old, but he caught the attention of those who were much older than him. To make a long story short, that person I developed, he is now the cluster head, leading 5 satellites in Cavite. He's 34. Okay? And I am now training him to be my replacement as the regional pastor. You see, in multiplying people, you have to look at them, you have to observe them, you have to see how the dynamics among the group. And you start to, in your mind, okay, you start flagging. You start flagging the people in your group that you feel is a multiplier. That is what we're going to take up this afternoon. Why do we need to develop multipliers? Okay, why do we need to develop multipliers? So we're going to do part one. We're going to look at the importance of a leadership pipeline, creating a succession plan in your team. And second is developing or looking at the leadership development process so that you can use it. Ito na yung nuts and bolts of multiplying. Ito na yung practical aspect of what we need to do. And I'm praying that this will help you. This will help you as you bring your people, as you bring the men and women that you are discipling into the direction that God wants them to go. Okay. In order to multiply, you have to have a multiplication plan. In other words, we have to look at our members and see them and develop them to be leaders of leaders. You know, one of the things, the way I compare it, the way I compare our leadership, is it's like building the skyway. You know, every day, every Wednesday, I travel from the house, papunta rito, di ba? And I would always pass by C5, and I would see these posts, di ba, mga poste, and then I would see an unfinished portion ng skyway that's being built. And whenever I go to Makati, I would also see certain portions. In isolation, it looks like random posts, random things, something happening in Otis, something happening in West Avenue, something happening along North Avenue, all of these things, but makikita mo putol-putol. And you know na unless it gets connected, it is useless. But there is somebody, a master planner, who has created in his mind and in a plan a way to connect all of this. Nag-uumpisa lang from somewhere else. But one day, after it is finished, you will see a well-connected skyway that brings it to one singular direction, which is to bring people out from the south, connecting the South Superhighway with the North Luzon Expressway. Right? That is the direction. But it starts to get built slowly. It is the same when you look at the leadership pipeline. You have one direction that you need to take, and that is to reproduce yourselves. But you have a lot of lives that you have to build up. Because one day, as you bring all of them together and you create the team that multiplies, then you bring everybody in the direction that you, in your mind, have visualized. It is an intentional way of developing potential leaders so that you will have your next in line. Kayo yung master planner. Kayo yung D group leader. You are the discipler that God has given the privilege of planning out how people that He sends to you to become an effective leader of leaders. Kayo yun. Tayo yun. And we should not waste that. The importance of the leadership pipeline is to create Christian leaders. Now, what is a Christian leader? By definition, a Christian leader is a servant who uses his credibility and capabilities to influence people in a particular context to pursue his God-given direction. Okay? In other words, our role is to have the credibility and capability to take a look at people, observe them, by the power of the Holy Spirit, help them in their context to pursue the purpose that they have in their lives. Yun yung role natin. That is what a Christian leader is. It is helping people become the people that God wants them to be. Okay? Therefore, if we are unable to perform and do these things, then we will not be able to produce the leaders that we want to develop. We need to bring them through a leadership development program, a pipeline of building them up, okay, and developing them. Now, leadership development defined is this. Leadership development is a process of helping leaders at every level of ministry assess and develop their Christian character and to acquire, reinforce, and refine their ministry knowledge and skills. Okay? In other words, the moment you identify people, you put them into a process of developing not only their character, but also their skills, helping them at the different levels of their ministry life to become effective. You see, my friends, as I've mentioned, I'm still a D group leader. I'm a D12 leader. Okay? I have friends who are not pastors, but who are D group leaders. We have in my group, I think we now have about 7 generations. Okay, 7 generations. And at the 7th generation, we are helping them become D group leaders as well. Why? Because that is our role. It is to insert ourselves into the lives of these people, help them in their spiritual journey, make them or help them become the person that God wants them to be. Develop their skills. And as they develop their skills, put them in the different levels of ministry until finally God will use them in the ministry or the purposes that God has for them. Not all of us will become pastors. Okay? Not all of us. Hindi ko kayo, don't worry. Okay? Baka natatakot kayo. Baka umabsent kayo next week. Last na yun. Okay? Wag. Not all of you will become pastors. But all of you have been called by the Lord to impact the lives of other people who may or may not become pastors themselves. That through you may not become pastors, you may become an effective D group leader or a D12 leader, but it is possible that somebody that God sends in your life, God is grooming to become a pastor. Therefore, we should help him discover that path, okay? So, why do we focus on developing the leader's pipeline? First, we should have a servant mindset. The moment we start to have an entitlement mindset, we create followers. Okay? Pagka-entitled tayo, feeling natin, I'm the D-group leader, you should follow me, di ba? Kahit na ano, basta kailan. If you're going to buy anything, you have to ask me. Di ba? Magpapalit ka ng damit, tawagan mo muna ako para tama ang color coordination mo. Okay? Kung ano man ang gagawin mo, okay? Kung wala kang sasakyan, you call me. Ano ba, magta-taxi ba ako, magda-grab ako? Tawagan mo ako, I will help clarify. That is an entitled mentality. And when we have a leader, entitled leader mentality, we do not create leaders. We create followers. Followers who are so dependent on us, okay, that they can never escape, or they are, para silang nakakulong sa'yo. And when you go, whether God takes you home out of embarrassment for what you are doing in the lives of others, or moves you somewhere else, again, out of embarrassment, you leave behind a group of sheep without a shepherd, and they're going to scatter. And that group will be lost. So, servant mindset. Second is you have to focus on developing personal and leadership credibility. You know, Henry Kusas in his book, Leadership Challenge, says this: the effectiveness of a message is dependent on the messenger. If the messenger is not believable, the message will not be believable. That's what credibility is. Okay? We have a wonderful message. We know that what we have to develop. But if we do not have the right attitude, then we will not be able to develop others as well. Yan ang kailangan nating i-focus. You know, itong personal leadership credibility, my personal and leadership credibility was at one point in my life put to the test. You see, I have a love affair. I confessed this to my wife. I had a love affair with food. Okay, I love food. Food loves me. And we hug each other so well, it comes out in the belly. Okay? So I have a love affair with food. I enjoy eating food. I enjoy eating. I'm diabetic. Okay? Pero ito ang laging binibiro ko. I use it as a joke. Sabi ko, nag-insulin naman ako eh. Di ba? Kahit tayong Chrissy Pata, nag-insulin naman ako. So pwede. So I was using that as a joke. Until one time, we were in a group. Okay, meron kaming kainan. And one of the men that I'm discipling is also insulin dependent. Okay? And the wife of this person was trying to control him. Sabi, wag kang kumain ng ganyan. And then maya-maya nakatingin sa akin ng masama yung wife. So nagtataka ako, bakit? Di ba? Bakit nagagalit yung asawa niya? Wala naman akong ginagawa sa kanya. Okay, so she talked to my wife. And here's her statement. Pagsabihan mo nga yung asawa mo, ako yun. Okay? Kasi hindi ko makontrol yung asawa ko sa pagkain niya. Kasi ang lagi niya sinasabi, bakit sinet? Eh, discipler ko yan. Okay? Kung kaya niyang kumain, kaya kong kumain. Kasi, discipler ko siya. You know, that hit me. That really hit me hard. Because I realized that I have destroyed my leadership credibility to this person. I was doing something that I should not do. And was joking about it. Okay? I was joking about it. And it affected him and his wife. So immediately, I stopped showing him whenever I eat. No. I stopped. Okay? I stopped. Pinipili ko na yung kinakain ko. Why? Kasi naapektuhan ko siya. And I was thinking, alam mo, iniisip ko, if this guy was thinking of that way of me, then most probably all of them has the same impression of me. And that's not good. Because my leadership and personal credibility has been put into question. Okay, so focus on personal and leadership credibility. Third is the capabilities of the person. Help them in their skills. Last week, I mentioned to you that I asked them to read books. And I really do, up to now. Okay, I asked them to read books. Why? Because I want their capabilities to improve. I want to help them. Ayoko na pag umalis sila sa akin, yung capacity nila for leadership is the same when they join my group. I have to make sure that they grow. So focus on that. Number four, influence on others. Leadership is influence. Therefore, you have to help them become influential. I teach them even the way that they should speak. No, we do preaching classes for them. I let them teach small groups because I have to build them in that area. I talk to them about how to get buy-in. Di ba? Paano mo i-influence ang tao? Volunteers. And I teach them. And then, of course, impact on followers. If we want our leaders to be strong in building up other leaders, they have to have impact on their followers. In other words, they have to be so credible that when they say something, people would actually do it. Ano yung impact sa buhay ng ibang tao? But overall, the key is to develop a servant's mindset. I always tell the men that I disciple, look for people who is better than you. Do not be satisfied in discipling people who has the same capacity as you are. Because yung capacity mo to pass on what you know deteriorates over time. Therefore, get somebody who is a lot better than you, somebody who has the higher potential, somebody who can speak better than you, and develop that person so that when you leave the ministry, when you leave your small group, they will have a leader who can bring them into greater heights than you can ever bring them. Yan dapat ang, that's how we should focus in developing our small groups. Okay? So why do we need to intentionally select and develop a leadership pipeline? Why do we have to bring people in? Why do we have to have a plan for every person that God sends our way? First of all, Jesus modeled the priority of developing leaders. Because among his group, among the disciples that he was discipling, he chose 12 among the thousands. He chose 12, trained them in the 3 years that he was with them. And these 12, when he left, pinagbilinan niya, you shall be my witnesses. And the church happened, the body of Christ. And as the church grew, there was this diaspora, people were scattered, and so they were able to reach the world. Therefore, Jesus modeled multiplication. Okay? So we have to understand that whatever it is that we're doing, it is biblical. Developing leaders who develop leaders, multiplying yourself, okay, has a biblical basis. Because Jesus actually modeled it. Second, the quality of the leadership determines the quality of the ministry. The speed of the leader is the speed of the team. Okay? Ano ibig sabihin ito? The quality of who you are in leading will be reproduced in the people that who are following you. Your attitude, your behavior, actually, nahahawa sila. So if you are excellent, okay, if you are excellent in everything that you do, if you are not satisfied with the mediocre, mapapansin mo, even the people that you're discipling will have that kind of mindset. Okay? The quality of your leadership, of our leadership, determines the quality of the ministry that we are in or the D group that you're in. The speed of the leader is the speed of the team. Okay? Pag mabagal tayo in developing them, mabagal din ang growth nila. Mabagal din ang galaw ng team ninyo. Okay? So, depende sa atin yan. Everything is dependent on us as leaders. You know, I think I mentioned it. I don't know if this is the group that I mentioned it to or it's another group. I can't remember, but I'll mention it anyway. You know, in our team, pag nagmi-meeting kami, and I see yung ganda nung, kanyari, nag-uusap kami, meron kaming works, no? After meeting, we will discuss what we're going to do. And there's a great idea that comes from them. I would always tell them, that's such an amazing idea. I'm so excited. Excited ako dyan sa idea na yan, bro. Kailangan magawa natin yan. The moment na sinabi kong excited ako, ninenervyos sila. Really, I'm not kidding. Pero they become excited as well. They become excited. And in fact, tinetest ko yan. I would let them have their own meetings. Hindi kami mag-a-attend, me and my wife. We don't attend. And then, the following day, I would call si Fred. Fred, ano nangyari sa meeting? Pastor, excited kami. Meron kaming naging decision. Di ba? Why? Because that is how I train them. The speed of your team is dependent on you. Okay, it's dependent on you. Okay. Third, leaders expand the ministry by making more leaders. The growth curve is the leadership curve. Ano ibig sabihin ng the growth curve is the leadership curve? Your group's capacity, your discipleship group's capacity to grow exponentially is dependent on your capacity to train leaders. Unless you are able to bring your leaders into a growth curve that you want, yung growth ng inyong small group, yung growth ng inyong discipleship growth, ng discipleship group will be slow. Because the very growth that you have as a ministry, as a discipleship group, is dependent on how fast you are able to develop leaders. Kaya makikita natin, if you look historically, the discipleship groups that are really expanding, you will notice most of the leaders of that group is so focused in developing other leaders. The growth curve is the leadership curve. Next, leadership development recognizes the value of people. Therefore, all processes are discipleship processes. As I mentioned, discipleship is life on life. It is touching the life of other people. And the moment we identify them, we tell them that they are valuable. Okay, that they are valuable. If we do not develop leaders, then we are telling them, you know, you're not, I'm valuable. That's why God sent you to me. This is the message we give them if we don't develop our leaders. I am valuable because God sent you to me. Therefore, I am valuable to you. Because if I do not disciple you, you will have no value. Kung hindi ka nagde-develop ng leaders. But if you really believe that they are valuable, you train them to become leaders. In other words, when you start training people to become D group leaders, what you are telling them is this: God sent you to me because you are valuable. Therefore, since you are valuable to God, I will pour my life out to you so that your value will be enhanced and you can be leaders as well. Okay, so when we talk about leadership, it's a discipleship process. Therefore, it is telling people, you are valuable. Okay, you are valuable. Will they make mistakes? Of course. Let them, sa akin, D group leaders, allow them to make mistakes. Let them learn. Okay? Let them learn. We all started at that point. But when we tell them these things, when they are put in a leadership, you show value to them, that they are important, and they are important to God. Okay? God's proteges are the leader's ministry legacy. The gospel is always one generation away from extinction. Okay, the gospel is one generation away from extinction. What does this mean? If we do not develop leaders who will have the heart to develop others, at a certain point, the next generation will lose the love for Jesus. And Christianity as we know it, the gospel as we know it, will be extinct. Okay? Kasi hindi nagmumultiply. Okay? So we, God uses us, if you look, pansin ninyo, I don't have my Bible, but if you look at Romans chapter 10, okay, 11 to 15, I believe, it talks about the importance of us bringing the Word of God to others. Okay, if you look at Romans chapter 10, 11 to 15, silipin nyo na lang yun. You will see the importance of us bringing the gospel. Therefore, our ministry legacy is this. More than anything, more than the bridging event, it is to teach our men or your women to disciple, to evangelize. You have to model it. Okay, you have to model it. You have to show them how to do it. They should catch you sharing the gospel. And then, kailangan yan, ma-feel nila yan. You know, when I mentioned last Sunday, the importance of reaching out to the youth, yun yung heart ko talaga. I really have a heart for the youth. Kasi yun sa dinaanan ko. Okay? And, you know, when God saved me, allowed me to be here where I am right now, it has given me the opportunity to reach out to the youth. Kasi lost talaga sila. Okay? Now let me segue for a little. I always advise the men that I disciple, sino sa inyo ang married with kids? Okay, this is for you. Okay? Insert yourselves into the lives of your kids. Share the gospel with them. Do not assume that they know the gospel. Okay, do not assume that they know the gospel. You know, bakit ko ito sinishare? You know, I'm discipling one guy. He comes from a Christian background. Lumaki yung anak niya from a Christian background. Last year, he came to me. Okay, he was the lead overseer of a satellite. He came to me, sat down with me and said, Pastor Net, meron akong konting problema. So sabi ko, ano yun? Sabi ko, kasi last night, sabi niya, kausap ko yung anak ko, kaisa-isa kong anak. And I asked him, anak, why are you no longer joining Elevate? And he answers, ayoko na eh. And then sabi, so how is your relationship with Jesus? And the answer that the son gave, ito ano, he was 19 years old at the time. Jesus is nothing to me. I go to church because you go to church. Now, you know, I felt the devastation that he felt. So sabi ko, bakit? Ano ang nangyari? Ito yung sagot niya, Pastor, binigyan ko naman siya ng Bible. Nung siya'y bata, nag-Sunday school naman siya. Kasama namin siya sa ministry. Tumutugtog siya dati. So sabi ko sa kanya gano'n, sabi ko, bro, just because binigyan mo siya ng Bible doesn't make him a Christian. And that struck me because it hits so close to home. Here is this guy that I dearly loved. We've been together for so long. And I've seen his son grow up, literally. And at that point last year when I heard that, sabi ko, wow, Di ba? Even our children. Sabi niya, ngayon, sabi ko gano'n, so you share the gospel with him. Sabi niya gano'n, nahihirapan daw siya. Sabi ko, wala tayong magagawa. You have to share the gospel with him. And so, ang advice ko sa atin, this is very important. No? Maybe I've segued a little, but I feel that this is so important. Parents, every, at least once a year or twice a year, sit your son or your daughter down and ask her or him, who is Jesus to you? You have to do it. I do it. I do it with my son. I do it with my daughters. Up to now, they are serving. They are in ministry. Okay, but I would sit with them. Minsan magkasama kami, my son, we were traveling home. And this is how I told him. Sabi ko, Mark, I love you. And I want you to understand that I love you very much. But I want to know, how is your relationship with Jesus? Who is Jesus to you? And he would explain it to me. And then I would tell him, so you mean, even if you die now, you don't have to do any works, you're going to heaven. And he says, yes, because the blood of Jesus has already cleansed me. You see, my friends, develop leaders. Make sure that every single person that you are discipling knows who Jesus is. And that he or she has a relationship with God. Make sure. Okay, so kunyari nagwa-one-on-one kayo. Nga ako, ginagawa ko ngayon. Pagkakausap ko, katulad kailan lang. Ito, pastor, kausap ko. Si Pastor Fred. I was with him last Tuesday. I was in his office. And I was talking to him. Nagwa-one-on-one kami. And then I asked him, sabi, Fred, who is Jesus to you? How are you related to him? And he would explain to me. Why? Because I have to keep on reminding him, making himself remember who Jesus is. Okay? So share with your disciples, just because he is attending your D group, do not assume that they have a relationship with Jesus. Do not assume. Okay? Kasi kung assume tayo ng assume, parang bagyo yan. Diba? Ma-assume tayo, malakas, pero wala palang dating. Okay? So help them. Okay? Because the gospel is always one generation away. Okay. Now, what are the common problems that delay the leadership pipeline? Our inability to identify, train, and develop leaders. This is the biggest stumbling block for us. When we do not know how to identify leaders, and we do not know what we are looking for, then it creates a delay in developing leaders. Later on, we're going to give you yung key kung ano yung hahanapin ninyo and to help you start off. Unhealthy need for control of the ministry. When you micromanage your group, when the fear is that your D group member will commit a mistake. Because when they commit a mistake, it will reflect on you. Now, I'm not saying that you give them a free rein. That's not what I'm saying. But what I'm saying is that you give them allowances. Set guidelines for them. Okay? And then let them move. Parang ano yan? Parang, meron kaming aso dati na yung, ang pangit, ano? Aso pa yung example, no? Hindi, wala ko kasi yung maisip na iba. Ito, meron nung yung leash na parang nakarol. Okay? And it is retractable. So, yeah, I would release, kunyari, we're walking, and our dog wants to run, I would release it. Hahaba yung leash niya. So, the dog now feels that it has the freedom. Di ba? Kasi tumatakbo siya, malayo-malayo, di ba? Pero the moment nakita ko that he would move in a place, kunyari, may nakita ko, may padating na tricycle, I would really press it, it stops him. And then I reel him in. Okay, I reel him in. Why? Kasi ayoko siyang masagasaan. Okay, I am holding his leash. I allow him to do basically what he wants to do. It gives him a feeling of freedom. Feel niya free siya. Pero when I see the danger, I reel him in. It's the same with your men and your ladies. Give them the feeling of freedom. But be there to reel them in when danger comes along. Okay, when we need to put accountability. Third, if the church is a task-oriented church culture. If we move, I praise God that CCF is not a task-oriented, does not have a task-oriented church. I hope, I think. That's how I see it. Okay? We are not task-oriented. When you say task-oriented, disciple development takes second place to accomplishing a task. Kumbaga, huwag na muna natin develop. Tapusin muna natin itong ano, may key result area tayo. Meron tayong mga KPIs na hinihit. Okay? The moment the church has that feeling, it changes the flavor of discipleship. It delays development. Okay? Number five, lack or no vision for the ministry. That's why I'm saying, have a vision for your D group. Have a vision for the people that you're discipling.